Dearly beloved, we have come together in the presence of Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, to render thanks for the great benefits that we have received at His hands, to set forth His most worthy praise, to hear His holy word, and to ask for ourselves and on behalf of others those things that are necessary for our life and our salvation. And so that we may prepare ourselves in heart and mind to worship Him, let us kneel in silence and with penitent and obedient hearts confess our sins, that we may obtain forgiveness by His infinite goodness and mercy. We say together, Almighty and most merciful Father, we have erred and strayed from Thy ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against Thy holy laws. We have left undone those things which we ought to have done. And we have done those things which we ought not to have done. But now, O Lord, have mercy upon us. Spare Thou those who confess their faults. Restore Thou those who are penitent. According to Thy promises, declare unto mankind. In Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant, O most merciful Father, for His sake, that we may hereafter live a godly, righteous, and sober life, to the glory of Thy holy name. The Almighty and merciful Lord grant you absolution and remission of all your sins, true repentance, amendment of life, and the grace and consolation of His Holy Spirit. Amen. O Lord, open Thou our lips,
and our mouth shall show forth Thy praise.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. As it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. We continue on page 45 with Jubilate, Psalm 100. We say together, O be joyful in the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness, and come before His presence with a song. Be ye sure that the Lord, He is God. It is He that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are His people, and the sheep of His pasture. O go your way into His gates with thanksgiving, and into His courts with praise. Be thankful unto Him, and speak good in His name. For the Lord is gracious, His mercy is everlasting, and His faithful endureth from generation to generation. Psalm 103. Out of the depths have I called to you, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears consider well the voice of my supplication. If you, Lord, were to know what is done amiss, O Lord, who could withstand? For there is forgiveness with you, therefore you shall be feared. I wait for the Lord, my soul waits for Him. In His word is my hope. My soul waits for the Lord, more than watching for the morning. O Israel, wait for the Lord, for there with the Lord there is mercy. With Him there is plenteous redemption, and He shall redeem Israel from all their sins. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. A reading from Ezekiel chapter 37, verses 1 through 14. The hand of the Lord came upon me and brought me up by the Spirit of the Lord and set me down in the middle of the valley. It was full of bones. He led me all around them. There were very many by me. says the Lord God to these bones, I will cause breath to enter you, and you shall live. I will lay signs upon you, and you cause flesh to come upon you, and cover you with skin, and put breath in you, and you shall live. And you shall know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied as I have been commanded, and as I prophesied, suddenly there was a noise, a rattling, and the bones came together, bone to bone. I looked, and there were sinews on them, the flesh had come upon them, and skin had covered them. There was no breath in them. Then he said to me, prophesy to the breath, prophesy, mortal, and say to the breath, thus says the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe upon these slain, that they may live. I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came upon into them, and they lived, and stood on their feet, a vast multitude. Then he said to me, mortal, these bones are the whole house of Israel. They say, well, our bones are dried up, and our hope is lost. We are cut off completely. Therefore prophesy and say to them, thus says the Lord God, I am going to open your graves and bring you up from your graves. O people, I will bring you back from the land of Israel. You shall know that I am the Lord, when I open your graves and bring you up from your graves, O my people. I will put my spirit within you, you shall live, and I will place you on your own soil. Then you shall know that I, the Lord, have spoken and will act, says the Lord. Let's keep that.
Now say in unison on page 50 of the Book of Common Prayer, the Song of Zechariah.
Rabbi, you were just not trying to stone you. Are you under again?
Jesus answered, "Are there not 12 hours of daylight? Those who walk in the day do not stumble, because they see the light of the world. But those who walk at night stumble, because the light is not in them." After saying this, he told them, "Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I am going there to awaken him." The disciples said to him, "Lord, if he has fallen asleep, he will be all right." Jesus, however, had been speaking about his death, but they thought he'd be primarily merely to sleep. Then Jesus told them plainly, "Lazarus is dead. For your sake, I am glad I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him." Thomas, who was called the twin, said to his two fellow disciples, "Let us also go that we may die with him." When Jesus arrived, he found that Lazarus had been dead in the tomb for 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, some 2 miles away, and many of the Jews had come to Mary and Martha to console them about their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him, while Mary stayed home. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that God will give you whatever you ask of him." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha said to him, "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection of the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord, I believe you that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, the one coming into the world." When she had said this, she went back and called her sister Mary and told her privately, "The teacher is here and is calling for you." And when she heard, she got up quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet come to the village, but was still the place where Martha had met him. The Jews who were with her in the house, consoling her, saw Mary get up quickly and go out. They followed her because they thought that she was going to the tomb to weep there. When Mary came to where Jesus was and saw him, she knelt at his feet and said to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping and the Jews who came to her also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. He said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, "Lord, come and see." Jesus began to weep. So the Jews said, "See how you loved him?" But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind have kept this man from dying?" Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, already there is a stench because he has been dead 4 days." Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone, and Jesus looked upward and said, "Father, I thank you for having heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so that they may believe that you sent me." When he had said this, he cried with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!" The dead man came out, his hands and feet bound with strips of cloth, and his face wrapped in a cloth. Jesus said to them, "Unbind him and let him go." Many of the Jews, therefore, who had come with Mary and had seen what Jesus did, believed in him. The word of the Lord.
We have to ponder what it might be like to be
when the light of hope seems to be utterly extinguished, with no way to reignite it. I wonder if some of us are approaching this line right now. More than ever before, there are some indications that aspects of life in the United States that we have known and loved for generations are disappearing and may not ever return. Even when we have emerged from the intensity of this moment, some beloved businesses and restaurants we have patronized for years may be shuttered for good. Recent days have certainly shattered any illusions we may have had about the invincibility of our nation's systems for providing food, medical care, education, and other basic necessities and comforts of life. Mortal, can these bones live? No. No, I don't think they can. It's fitting that the two scripture stories we get on this final Sunday, leading up to our annual observance of Christ's passion and resurrection, are the Valley of Dry Bones from Ezekiel and Jesus raising of Lazarus in the Gospel of John. These are, after all, the readings where the rubber of our faith really meets the road. All hope is gone. Israel is destroyed, dispersed, and driven into exile, and nothing but the bones of her finest warriors remains. Lazarus is dead and has been in the tomb long enough that there's already a stench. And in both cases, when questioned by the Lord, the humans in the drama are initially uncertain at best about whether any hope of life remains in the situation. These readings take us in spirit to what is arguably the hardest day to observe in our entire life of faith. And that day is Holy Saturday. It's probably fair to say that even Good Friday is easier. Good Friday gives us something to do. We can empathize with our Savior's pain. We can be thankful for his laying down his life for us. Or we can rail against the sheer injustice of it all. But on Holy Saturday, we're beyond all that. All has gone still. And there's nothing left to do but to keep vigil with the dry bones. We trust in that moment that resurrection is to come, but we do not know when or how. And we must wait, probably much longer than we would like, in the stillness where everything is accomplished and there's nothing left to do. But perhaps the stillness isn't as empty as it might seem. As I read these stories again, year after year, something ever more powerful seems to emerge from between the lines of the text. In the simple act of sticking with God through that moment of dereliction to see what might come next, I believe that Ezekiel, Mary, and Martha experience a blessing that exceeds the obvious one. Not only did they witness the promised resurrection, but in the moment leading up to that miracle, a piece of that resurrection power lodged in their souls in a place where it could never differences? Or will everything just return to business as usual? There's absolutely no way to know at this moment. And we're not asked to know. All that is asked of us is that in the middle of the chaos, in the middle of the uncertainty, we wait with a patient trust. When we are presented with the dry bones and asked if they can live, we don't even need to say yes. We just need to answer, "Oh Lord God, you know," and then wait for the miracle to happen. And we can rest assured that it will indeed happen, because we know something that Ezekiel, Mary, and Martha didn't know. We know that the Easter miracle occurred. So whenever we're looking at destruction or death, while we cannot know exactly when and how, we know that resurrection will happen. The tomb is not an easy place to stay. A valley of dry bones is not a pleasant sight to behold. And this moment may not be an easy one to face. But since we had no choice but to face it, let's do so well. Let's sit and wait in sure and certain hope of the resurrection. It may seem to delay, but Easter is surely coming, bringing with it indescribable gifts. Those willing to wait. Amen.
Amen.
Now continue our worship together on page 53 in the Book of Common Prayer as we proclaim together the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third above the sundry and manifold changes of the world, our hearts may surely there be fixed, where true joys are to be found. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. O God, who makest us glad with the weekly remembrance of the glorious resurrection of thy Son, our Lord, grant us this day such blessing through our worship of thee, that the days to come may be spent in thy favor, through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Lord Jesus Christ, who didst stretch out thy arms above on the hardwood of the cross, that everyone might come within the reach of thy saving embrace, so clothe us in thy Spirit, that we, reaching forth our hands in love, may bring those who do not know thee to the knowledge and love of thee, for the honor of thy name. We now sing together, I Want to Walk as a Child of the Light, which is hymn number 490 in the hymnal 1982.
receive these our prayers, which we offer unto the Divine Majesty, beseeching thee to inspire continually the universal Church with the spirit of truth, unity, and comfort, and grant that all those who confess thy holy name may agree in the truth of thy holy word and live in unity and God and love. Lord, have mercy upon us. Give grace, O Heavenly Father, to all bishops and other ministers, especially Justin, Archbishop of Canterbury, Michael, our presiding bishop, and Mark, our bishop, that they may both in their life and doctrine set forth thy true and lively word, and rightly and duly administer thy holy sacraments. In the Anglican cycle of prayer, we lift up to you this day a season of prayer and repentance throughout the communion. In our Episcopal diocese, we pray for St. Martin's Church in Crockett. In our local community, we pray for Asbury United Methodist Church in Livermore. Lord, have mercy upon us. And to all thy people, give thy heavenly grace, and especially to this congregation here present, that with meek heart and due reverence, they may hear and receive thy holy word, truly serving thee in holiness and righteousness all the days of their life. In the weekly cycle of prayer, we lift up to you these members of our congregation: Jerry Patterson, James Payne, Vern Phillips. As well as those in military service: Aaron Bottoms, Valerie Manuel, Amber Rice, Christopher Weaver, and Taylor Williamson. Lord, have mercy on us. We beseech thee also to rule the hearts of those who bear the authority of government in this and every land, as trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. Additional petitions of thanksgiving may be added here. Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate.